So I'm just going to go, I have my alphabetical list. I'm going to go alphabetically. So I'll begin with Matt Downs. And why don't you take the first stab at my first question, which is very simple. Please introduce yourself, describe your background, your education, your training, the jobs that you've had since your master's degree, and you know, with a focus on your current job. And tell us what you do at your current job as a biostatistician.
Great. Well, thanks so much for having me. I have to say, I wish we had something like this back when I was a master's student. But so I am a statistician. I work at a company called Statistics Collaborative, which is based in Washington, D.C. We're a group of about 35 statisticians and support staff. So 50 of us in total, but 35 statisticians. So it's kind of nice. You have a lot of people to bounce ideas off of and colleagues, if you're in a bind and don't know what to do, people to ask questions and get help from. So we mainly work in the pharmaceutical and biotech arena. And one of the main activities I do is support of data monitoring committees, which are a group, each trial, and not every trial has one, but at least most phase three trials do. It's a group of experts who basically review the data in the middle of the trial while the drug company is masked to what's going on. So they're actually privy to the interim data. And so they're reviewing the data to determine whether, you know, it's acceptable to continue the trial, that it's in the best interests of participants to continue, that there's no safety issue that would preclude continuation. We also generally review efficacy data if there's a formal interim efficacy analysis. We'll also sometimes review efficacy data even if it's not a formal analysis, just to allow the committee to assess risk versus potential benefit to participants. But it's kind of a fun job in that you see the results of the trial as they're emerging. And you see, you know, you see this before anyone else. So my background is I actually, my undergraduate, I went to SUNY Geneseo, which is a small campus in cold and snowy Western New York. I'm sure it's quite cold and snowy right now. And I actually got my undergraduate in biology and actually anthropology. So not a mathematics background. But I didn't really know all that much about biostatistics, but I thought it was a good application of those two degrees. And I went to the EpiBiostat MPH program at UC Berkeley and managed to get through there with a degree. It was touch and go at sometimes. And you know, in my last semester there, I started applying for jobs back on the East Coast. And actually, the job at Statistics Collaborative, this is my one and only, I guess, grown-up job that I've had. And so I've actually been there, now I'm giving away my age, I've been there about 25 years. So I don't have a breadth of experience from different jobs to tell you about, just my one. But anyhow, that's probably good enough now for an introduction. So
yeah,
thanks everyone.
Thank you. Okay, Ruth Eisenberg. So I know you switched jobs recently, so please tell us your background and trajectory and what you've done.
My undergrad, I did at Barnard College in statistics, and then I did a master's in biostatistics at Columbia. And then my first job I found through a professor I had worked on a research project with when I was a master's student. She was the head of biostats for psychiatry at Columbia, which is sort of like, it's psychiatry sort of like almost like a separate institution. So after I graduated, I ended up working there in the psychiatry department with a group that did psychiatric epidemiology studies. So they would do sort of studies in the community, of risk factors for psychiatric disorders. Like they did studies of children of first responders to 9/11 and children whose parents were incarcerated, focused on psychiatric epidemiology in children. So I was sort of like an in-house statistician for their particular group. And then after I was there for about 3.5 years, I moved to a job at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, which is a medical school in the Bronx. And there I was part of a sort of like a centralized biostatistics group of about 20 biostatisticians, mostly with PhDs and a few of us with masters. And I worked on clinical research projects with faculty, meaning basically doctors from different clinical departments. So that was sort of, as opposed to my first job, I was part of a biostatistics group. So I worked a lot more with other statisticians and I could learn from more senior statisticians. And I worked on lots of different areas of research as opposed to being sort of in-house with like one particular group. And also it was clinical research, like mostly doctors, doing research on patients, whether a lot of like retrospective studies that they're looking at sort of medical records that they have and what questions can they ask of them, but also some prospective studies and some randomized studies that they're doing, with the patients in their hospital, in their clinic. So like clinical research. So I would say both of those settings, I meet with investigators, help them figure out what's their research question, what's the best statistical approach to analyze the data, help design the study, whether in a grant application, like an NIH grant application, or writing up the statistical section for their IRB protocol of how they plan to conduct the study and make sure it's scientifically sound. And then I would analyze the data, create tables and figures, meet with them to go over the results, how to interpret them, and help with writing up manuscripts, the method section and the results section. And I used SAS in both of my first two jobs. I could have probably used other statistical software, but I mean, I personally used SAS and did a lot of, manipulating the data, cleaning the data and analyses. Which was most of what I did was sort of in the more like traditional family of, basic tests, non-parametric tests, regression, linear, logistic, Poisson regression, longitudinal models, survival analysis. So sort of like the more traditional toolbox, as opposed to, some of you may be interested in that, some of you may be interested in like big data, data science type of stuff. So I'm sort of in the first bucket. And then a few months ago in October, after being at Einstein for about 3.5 years, I started a new job at the medical device company, Medtronic. So I'm working on medical device clinical trials. It's called transcatheter aortic valve replacement. It's minimally invasive procedure to replace the aortic valve, which is like the valve that pumps the oxygenated blood out of the heart. So the device is basically the replacement valve and the system to implant it without doing minimally invasive way, without doing open heart surgery. So with medical devices, like with drugs, they have to do clinical trials to show the FDA and regulatory bodies in other countries that the device is safe and effective. I'm still new, relatively new there, but as a biostatistician, I'm responsible for the statistical analysis plan, specifying what the tables and figures should look like, and overseeing the analysis for regulatory reports for the FDA, publications on the studies, general requests, just working on with the study teams on all questions that come up related to statistical aspects.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, we will move to Martin Ho.
Hello, everyone. My name is Martin Ho. I am currently at the FDA Center for Biologics, and I've been there for 2 years. Before that, I was working for a Center for Devices at the FDA for 10 years as a reviewer. And before that, I was actually sitting on the opposite side of the table, just like Ruth, working for contract research organizations, preparing packages, submissions for the FDA. And also I was responsible for are doing quite a bit of what I would like to say, total life cycle of a clinical trial from talking with physicians to develop a draft of the protocol to talk to the IRB and then being a data coordinating center, talk to the sites, train the site research staffs, and then analyze the data, publish the manuscript. But that is, I think, the first job that I left graduate school. And I think in that period, I've learned so much. And it actually helped inform my later positions, working at the FDA. So long story short, my wife and I have been receiving a lot of benefits from this country's generous support in terms of education. So once we become eligible, to work for the federal government, meaning that my wife and I get naturalized, I applied for a position at the FDA and she applied for a position at Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. And so I think the most important thing that I want to tell you about is come work for the federal government if you can. We really need you. And I think if I can have a chance to talk to Ruth, then I hope that I can talk her into thinking about this. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Yang Liu.
Hi, good evening, everyone.
Hello.
Let me know if you can hear me clearly.
You're good, it's good.
Thank you so much for having me. It's my great pleasure to meet Rebecca and all the panelists and all the audiences, even if I can't see you. Actually, I have been working as a statistician since I was doing my master in 2016, and first as part-time, and then in 2017, I joined, my first job was actually with NYU, Marrow Institute of Urban Expansion, which is in your data science building, and it's downstairs of your data science programs. Actually, I went there for your free lunch all the time, and I really enjoyed the free. I really enjoyed the seminar, the lunch seminar. I think it was very well organized. And after NYU, I joined Mount Sinai Hospital as in the Environmental Epidemiology Department. So I work on, I will use machine learning, mainly XGBoost, to do environmental epidemiology. It was very exciting experience. I learned a lot at Mount Sinai, and then now I'm working at UNICEF, United Nations International Children's Fund. So our group we deal a lot with demographic data. The job of our team is to try to update and maintain the database for SDG child mortality indicators, mainly SDG 3.2. And my daily job includes lots of data collection, and also I need to evaluate the quality of the data and do some recalculation, and then we do a modeling of all the data sources to plot a smooth train, so we know how the child mortality trend changes for every country, and then we publish that every year. And also we need to do country consultation. Basically, we discuss with each country office how they think of our estimate and if they accept it. And that's basically my daily work nowadays. I work exclusively in R, so I'm an R programmer.
Jessica Velasquez.
Hi, everyone. So I graduated from Hunter College. With a major in sociology. So that was a little bit different. Then I did get interested in my senior year of college I took an epidemiology course, and I think that spurred my interest into public health. And then from there, I did enroll at NYU as an epidemiology student, but I did find that I was more interested in the data side of things. So while being enrolled, I did switch over to the biostatistics concentration, and I received my MPH in 2019. From then, I am a program coordinator at NYU School of Medicine. The site is at Bellevue Hospital. We do work with the Bellevue Hospital population. So just like what I do overall is I do oversee multiple research projects for Dr. Shauna Yin. She's a general pediatrician and associate professor at both the departments of pediatric and population health there. And our work mainly is on health literacy, so parent health literacy and how it impacts child's health. So we do work like on a variety of issues, some being like obesity prevention, chronic disease like atopic dermatitis, asthma, and we also have projects on like medication safety. So I do oversee data collection. I also do oversee like project timelines, deliverables, data analysis. I do work closely with other statisticians to make sure that they're on track with the data analysis on that side of things. And then on the other projects that are not as active, I do IRB renewals. In addition to that, we do prep manuscripts and abstracts, and I do help with that. And then I do also assist with grant writing and submission and target enrollment. So there's definitely a lot of different tasks that I do. And then I do also supervise research assistants and master students with their incoming thesis projects and just make sure the overall flow of all studies on the team is running properly.
Great, thank you. Okay, thank you all. Okay, so now I want to turn back. You all mentioned a little bit about your education and your background, but I want to focus on that now. Of course, having in mind that, you know, you're talking to students or to prospective students. And so my question is to please describe the most useful aspects of your education and your training with respect to what you are doing in your current job. And I guess I'll also throw in a question on top of that. What do you do to stay current? Again, a few of you sort of alluded to some things, but what do you do to learn new things, you know, as time goes on since you were actually a student? So useful aspects of your education, and what do you do to continue your education? How do you learn now? Okay, so Matt, we'll go back to you.
Sure. Well, I think one of the most important things for statisticians is being able to communicate with non-statisticians. And that's one thing I have to be honest with you. Perhaps I shouldn't say this, but I think a lot of statisticians actually aren't very good at that. and it's tough because it's what we're explaining is difficult, and it is intimidating to a lot of people who aren't statisticians. So when I started my master's program, for some reason they decided that the big public health, you know, intro to stat course, which all the non, you know, stat focused degrees have to take, you know, it's a big class. It's like about five, at Berkeley, it was about 500 students. And then they would have recitation sections where they would break you down into smaller groups. And they were like, well, Matt, you're gonna lead three of those. And I was sort of like frightened about that. And at that point, I didn't think that was going to be a good experience since I myself had never actually taken a graduate level statistics course. It very much was, learning the material the night before and sort of cramming. And I do have to say, in retrospect, that's a great way to learn it if you have to get in front of a bunch of people and try not to make a fool of yourself. But it also, I think, was a really useful experience for me to sort of, things that I'm like, oh, of course, this is obvious. And you're teaching to people who are like, no, that is not obvious, Matt. And how to communicate, you know, kind of complicated concepts, how to make it relatable. So I have to say, in retrospect, I didn't think that was going to be one of my favorite aspects of graduate school, but it actually really was. And I really think I gained a lot from that.
Great, thank you. Okay, Ruth.
I think probably what's probably the most still relevant for my master's program was like hands-on take-home projects where you had to analyze a real data set, you know, with statistical software, you know, interpret the results, justify why you chose the analysis methods that you chose, and you know why the conclusions that you're drawing. So I think like the statistical theory is very important, and it's especially like it does sort of like separate you from a lot of people today who are like data analysts and like work with data, but like don't really have training in like probability and statistical inference and like the nuts and bolts. So I think that stuff is important, but if you're going to be an applied statistician, I think like what's stuck with me, what probably was the most relevant still, is those like sort of applied projects. And I think for sort of continuing education also, I would say, like I have in the different places that I've been had the opportunities to hear talks from guest lecturers and to go to conferences a little bit. I think it's sort of, as you sort of practice applied statistics, you will always encounter new questions or new statistical issues that you maybe aren't as familiar with. And then sort of if you delve into that and sort of learn by doing and apply it, that's really the best way to learn.
Good, thank you. Okay, Martin.
Yes, perhaps instead of one, I would offer two. One buy one, get one free. My job is basically elevate the information that is beyond the traditional clinical trials in order to inform the FDA to make better regulatory decisions. And so therefore, this job involves a lot of out-of-the-box thinking. And also, it also involves a lot of asking questions and learning new stuff. So both learning stuff and asking questions has been something that I learned from my master's program at U of Wisconsin Medicine. There is a consulting class. And the first class, the first assignment that we were asked to do is not without doing anything, just talk to the person who have a problem and trying to use the person's language to convey what his problem is. So I think instead of using a statistician's problem or language to say, hey, perhaps he just wanted to do an ANOVA or do a t-test and it would be fine, and or just do a Kaplan-Meier curve. Rather, we wanted to be, sit in their shoes, think about what information he needs, what information they don't, and just provide just right piece of information that is useful for that person. I think this is another, I would say habit mostly, very important for a statistician nowadays, because when I look around, most of the people who work with me are the biomedical engineers, the physicists, and also the electrical engineers, they all can do statistical modeling to a certain level. However, what differentiates us from them is we can consider things in a causal inference perspective, and also trying to address the deep-rooted reason of things that are, the challenges that of the decision maker that really care about. And because of the nature of the different problems, we would know that right after school, the skill set that we have is already very inadequate. We have to pick up the new ones right away, because as I said, we shouldn't force the problem to feed into the tools that we have in hand. In other words, we shouldn't only have a hammer in hand so that everything looks like a nail. Rather, we will have to figure out exactly how we solve the problems. The two biggest problems that I have been facing is first, how to measure quantitatively a patient population's perspective in terms of the benefit risk trade-off of a medical product versus the control group, so to speak. That involved quite a bit of econometrics that I need to learn, learning by doing. And the second thing is even more interesting and challenging, which is how can we curate and use real-world evidence that comes in different sizes, shapes, and sources? How can we help use that to inform our decision? So anyway, I think it's a very good habit to pick up while in my program.
Great, thank you. Okay, Yang.
Yes, I think basically everything I was studying in school is quite useful in my job because statistics is highly applied. If you ask me, for myself, I think the most used one are the regression and the experiment design and the statistical learning, because that's what I do in my later job. Right? Because sometimes when you really work, sometimes what you need is just a linear regression, but of course you need to use it correctly and explain it correctly. And I don't think that's as easy as it looks. And when I was working in hospital, I use a lot of experiment design things. So we basically do some hypothesis testing. And when you interviewed for those companies, there will be technical interviews and they will ask you things like that, like t-test and over. And so you need to know those things very well and exactly what you learn in class. And of course, statistical learning is what everyone's doing. Everyone's doing machine learning cross validation thing. So that's absolutely very useful. And Rebecca asks a lot a good, very good question that how do you pick up new knowledges on the road? I think lots of the some of the most useful knowledge point were indeed picked up after I graduated from the program. Like in real statistical analysis, people use a lot of hierarchical modeling, but those are not quite covered to that depth in a normal experiment design course. It may not cover to the depth it should be. Like you need to be like how to run models with random effect, fixed effect, and wrong mixed models correctly. I think those things are, maybe you haven't been there yet, but those things are quite normally required in a statistician job. The second aspect I want to emphasize is R programming. So if you want to be serious about R, I recommend to read through the Hadley Wickman, Advanced R, and that's a very good book. So basically I studied R also by myself after I graduated. And I think to reach the desired level of, you need to try to study it by yourself. And I think that the book by Hadley is a very good book.
Okay, and Jessica.
Yeah, I think what's been most helpful from my job has specifically been about like study designs and then also like how statistical tests like apply as well. And just like understanding just like the overall like when to use a statistical test. Regressions are definitely being used a lot at our lab. So we do use like a lot of logistic regressions and linear regressions. So those classes have been definitely helpful. And I think also just like having the experience to have like a practicum and in addition to like a thesis. So like being able to carry a paper like from the beginning to end and really owning that. Like that was really helpful and like being able to have like the experience to work with real data at an early stage. Like that was really helpful specifically for my position. A little bit more about the continuing education aspect. I think something that has been beneficial to me has been just being part of meetings, like other like statistical meetings where more senior statisticians are discussing like the real life problems and just like hearing their thought process throughout like how they're going about solving problems. I think that has been really helpful for me. And then also NYU does offer guest lectures. So I would say that that has also been interesting to learn about. So not necessarily like topics that my lab is working on, but just hearing about other work being done outside of my lab.
Great, thank you. Okay, so I think, so this will be our final formal question that I will ask. And then following that, we'll have plenty of time to open up to questions from attendees. So the question is two parts, really. So is there anything that you would have done differently while you were a student, now that you have some perspective, some of you more than others, but some perspective, you know, since graduating and since getting your degree. So is there anything you would have done differently? Would you have taken courses that you didn't take? So that's one part. And then along with that is any advice that you have. So you've all given great advice, you know, throughout our discussion, but is there anything else that you would advise to students as they begin looking for jobs? So Matt.
Sure. Well, I realized I was really terrible at following your directions. I only answered part of my last question.
So you can go back to that.
Yes. So, you know, one thing, you know, I guess I do have the advantage that I, you know, there's 30 of us at the company. So there is a lot of shared knowledge. And, you know, we generally do have sort of like a monthly sort of brown bag where someone has to go and sort of talk about a new problem they're working on. And so you do get a lot of you absorb a lot of that. You know, the other thing that, you know, a lot of our work or my work, given that it's in pharma, is, you know, a lot of it is in SaaS, which I know isn't the case for a lot of people outside of maybe the clinical trials realm. And there's a really nice series of books that SaaS has called SaaS Books by Users. And I do have to say that most, it's nice in that it has a lot of very applied situations that I encounter in my work that, you know, and fortunately we have that in our library at work that I can go and sort of get advice and sort of read up on, okay, this is a similar issue that I'm facing for this trial that we're trying to design. You know, what did they do here? The other thing, you know, generally I go to, you know, one really good meeting I go to every year is the Society for Clinical Trials. You pick up a lot there just about what the current sort of current trends are in clinical trials and current thoughts. So anyway, that's sort of how I try to keep abreast. There's a lot, absolutely what people have been saying, there's a lot that changed since I went to graduate school. You know, one thing that, you know, probably there wasn't that, this course might not have existed or didn't really have a big focus was, you know, how to deal with missing data. You know, back when I started in clinical trials, like the sophisticated technique, it's not sophisticated, but the technique was just do last observation carried forward, which of course is full of biases. And so now obviously we're more inclined to do something like multiple imputation or things like that. And of course, that's not something I was covered in my 2-year grad program. So a lot of that is sort of like, I think as Martin said, you learn by doing. When you have to do it, you suddenly are like, okay, I'm back in student mode. I'm you know, researching just how to do this and how to approach this. I guess my advice to, I guess now I'm gonna try to follow directions. One thing would I do differently if I were to do grad school again? I think we did have an internship component between the first and second year, but I probably would have tried to work a little bit more with real world data because a lot of the data sets that we had, you know, for our homework exercises, they were nice and clean and tidy data. And in my work, I never get that. It's always, I'm usually working with interim data. So it hasn't gone through the cleaning process. And so I think honing that skill, and I would have had to do that if I was working with more like this is how the data are right now, warts and all, would have been helpful. Advice for job seekers. I gotta be honest with you, I haven't actually looked for a job in a while, but I do interview a lot of people. And so maybe I'll give some advice and some interviewing advice.
Great, sure.
One thing that you know we usually ask for as part of when people apply is obviously we ask for the usual things, but we also ask for a code sample. And it's surprising to me the number of people who just whip off some, you know, their homework exercise from school without any explanation or without any context. And presentation matters. So I'm looking for, you know, are you showing your thought process, a clear thought process in how you've set up your code? Have you documented your code? Because a lot of times, especially, I think this is true, it's certainly true for me, but I think it's true for a lot of people, the code you write is probably going to be used at some point from other people, or other people are going to have to modify that code. So you want to just make it very transparent and obvious what you're doing. And frankly, you know, just don't give me some programming code. Give me the context of what were you trying to do? What question were you trying to answer? And so that's something I would just keep in mind. It's not just a check the box sort of thing. Oh, I sent a code sample. The other sort of interviewing tip I would give, it's very surprising to me. A lot of people, you know, when we say, oh, do you have any questions? I would say about a third of people don't have any questions, which kind of shocks me. So, you know, maybe it's because people are like, I'll take whatever job. I just need a job. But I sort of feel like, listen, when you need to figure out, is this job going to be a good fit for you? So ask questions like, sort of like, well, what will I be doing? What did you do today? Like, tell me, you know, you interviewer, what's your day like? Because you get some insight into the company culture and sort of what they're really doing at that place. And the other thing, I guess I would say, and this is very old school, but absolutely send a thank you note afterwards. It doesn't have to be like on fancy stationery or anything. It can just be an email. But that has made the difference between someone getting, who was on the fence, whether they got the job or not, because you're like, oh, this was a really well, first of all, the person's smart enough to know that they should thank their interviewers. But also you're looking, you know, you're like, wow, this is actually a really nice spontaneous writing sample. This person can write and communicate. So anyway, those are sort of my advice in terms of interviewing, I guess.
Great. Well, thank you. Okay, so so on to you, Ruth. So the question, let me just go back, because Matt wrapped up a few all in one. So anything you wish you would have done differently while a student, and any advice you have for current students as they sort of begin thinking about their next steps?
I think there were probably, in my master's program, there were more sort of electives and different types of courses that I didn't take. Like, we had like a required class about clinical trials, but I think there was like a part two and part three. And like, you know, in the School of Public Health, you could take more, if you're interested in like a topic in epidemiology, I could have taken more classes outside of statistics. I mean, these are all just different examples. I'm not saying I should have done all of these. There was like statistical genetics, I don't know, data science, like big data, such as it was then. It was probably a little different even, I don't know, 7 years ago, 8 years ago. But anyway, sort of just, I sort of was like in and out in like three semesters. So I could have done another semester and taken more, or like an extra class on top of the requirements, you know, and one or more of those different areas, sort of, don't like write off something too soon. Is like, you know, eventually you have to be interested in something. You can't be probably interested in all those things, but you know, don't write something off too soon. Like, try sort of different things that are whatever is available to you. And I guess, yeah, for looking for jobs, I was getting sort of similar to Matt about, you know, you're trying to like present yourself in the best light, but also don't forget to pay attention to, you know, what is the job description, and to ask questions in the interview. Like, it's also a chance for you to figure out, you know, you don't want to be overly picky, you want to find a job, but still, you want to, don't settle on the first job that offers you, that you got an offer necessarily. Like, really think about, you know, what you're interested in, ask questions, So some of the things that I would ask, how much are you working under supervision? How much are you working independently? Do you have opportunities to learn from statistical colleagues, or are you sort of like the statistician? Are you working with different types of clients, which could be like an industry if you're at a CRO? You know, maybe you have different types of clients, or maybe you're in, like in an academic setting, you're in like a centralized biostat group where you work with different researchers, or you're with one clinical department in the medical center, or you're in-house at one pharmaceutical company where you work on trials of, you know, one specific compound for like, 10 years or something, I don't know. And what software do they use? How much are you data management and like data cleaning are you expected to do versus do you have data management support and data managers doing some of that for you? Because if you don't, that could take up a lot of your time and might not be as interesting and sexy as what you think the job is going to be. So that's something to pay attention to. And then also, how much of the statistical programming are you doing yourself? So when I worked in academic medical centers, I always did all of my own statistical programming. And nobody ever really checked it or validated it. It just sort of was trusted that I was, sometimes I would catch my own mistakes, but go over things, but it was just sort of was what it was. And now at the company where I am now, I like specify for statistical programmers, what analysis we want. And then they run it and they have much better, more sophisticated SAS programming skills than I ever did. And it all comes out sort of automated and looks very nice. And then I check, I double check that it's right, but I don't have to make it look pretty. So that's sort of a new thing for me also, is not really being the statistical programmer, just sort of validating it. So that's also sort of like, how much of that are you doing versus is it a role where you have that kind of support? So those are all suggestions I would suggest to think about, ask about.
Great, thank you. Okay, and Martin. Oh, you're muted.
Sorry. So I would like to propose two things. One is that try to solve problems more and estimate less. When I was in the master's program, a lot of our homeworks or problems are mostly surrounding doing hypothesis testing or estimation. But I think, use our statistical skill and try to solve some daily problems and decision problems that we encounter in our daily lives and make it a habit. And it will reward very handsomely in your career. For example, in my center, Center for Biologics, who would have thought that we need to prioritize or think about how to arrange the advisory committee date for different type of vaccine with different type of nature of administration. And that involves certain type of optimization in the public health context. And the second thing that I want to suggest is try something that programmer have been doing for quite a while, is called extreme programming, meaning that you have a partner sitting next to you. And while you're typing, doing your program, you're thinking out loud and let another person to look at what you're typing and trying to see if what you are explaining can help them understand your code real time. And then you can take turn and see how it goes. I have to say that even among programmers, it's a very, very highly pressures, highly, prized skill set, because it really can increase the accuracy and the efficiency of the programming. So that's pretty much it. Thank you.
Great. And advice for students as they're considering different types of jobs?
Oh, yes. It's to me, I think after all these years, the most important thing is my boss. I think there are people thinking, large company, very prestigious, small company, not so cool. But for me, even every shop has a star, and if you happen to be that star's protege, you will do good in the long run. So therefore, one of the questions when Matt just mentioned, do you have any question for me or for us? I would always raise my hand and say, who will be my future boss? And I would like to have 10 minutes to talk with him, making sure that we can have a good match. And that is, I think, is the most pragmatic way to get to know whether I would have a future in the company or not.
Okay.
Thank great. You.
Thank you. Okay. And Yang.
Hi, yes. I fully agree with Martin that try to get real world experience as early as possible will be helpful. I mean, it can be free. You don't have to be pay a lot, but like doing real world statistical consultation is very different from, you know, what you learn in class. I mean, even though it's just t-test, even though it's just an over linear regression, try to present what should be presented and don't overflow your audience or like tell them what they really care. That I mean, it's very hard to tell. It really needs to do some real thing and the real world project. That's a must done. And also there are some questions already raised, like how to prepare for jobs. I mean, if you are interviewing for jobs, they will ask for a real project. They will ask you to show them the code. So how would you plan, how do you plan to present your code? How do you plan to present your project? I would suggest to get familiar with the modern data science workflow as early as possible, which is basically, in my opinion, is R Markdown plus GitHub. So personally, I have a website, a research website, which is written exclusively in R. So it's R Markdown, and it's a website hosted on GitHub. And I think that's very helpful to me. It helps me a lot to get my jobs, because I don't need to write a lot on my resume. I only need to show them the website.
Great, thank you. And I can't resist jumping in and just saying, we actually have a program for our students planned. I think we have not announced it yet, but we're planning to have it in the next month. So for any of you students who are here, where we're gonna take you through all of those steps to do exactly what Yang just described, to have the profile through and using R Markdown and GitHub to do that. So thank you for suggesting that.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Okay.
That would be very exciting.
Yes.
What I would have done differently was, I think, work with different programs. I started with SCADA in my master's program, and then I wasn't comfortable like learning other programs because I didn't want to do poorly in my classes. So I didn't push myself to try to learn other programs. I just continued to work with the same program throughout. So I would have wanted to probably use that time to gain those other skill sets. And then I think I would have also recommend that if you do have an option to not work full-time, I mean, when I was doing my master's, I was working full-time. So I don't think I made as many as those connections or like was really integrated into the school as like some of the other students. I also did take 3 years to graduate instead of the 2 years. So people that I initially started off with graduated, and then it was just like, it was a little difficult to like build connections or ask questions or learn from others as well. So if it's a possibility to do the 2 year program.
Great, thank you. So really it's actually remarkable to hear from, you know, from the panelists coming from many different types of jobs, but to hear a lot of common themes. So that's very interesting. And of course there are differences also, but you know, finance isn't necessarily as different from research, you know, it is research or from, you know, an academic setting. There's certainly overlap as just one example. Okay, so we are able to take questions if people want to put them in the Q&A. And I know that people also sent in questions. So I am looking through. Okay, here's a question. And I'll just state the question and anyone can take it who wants to. The question is there a difference in your position in, you know, the industry that you're in between an MS, somebody coming with a master's of science, and somebody coming with a master's of public health, you know, with a concentration in biostatistics? Would there be any difference at the FDA or at an academic center? Or do you really just look at the courses the person has taken and you know, what they're prepared to do? So anybody who wants to take that.
I think it might be that now there isn't such a difference between an MS and biostatistics and an MPH, especially if you can sort of choose similar courses. But I think some of the people that I work with that maybe are a little bit more old school would perceive someone with an MPH as sort of having like a broader public health interest that might be better suited for a position where it's an MPH in biostatistics, so a position where you're doing some amount of data analysis, but you're also sort of focused on the broader, maybe you're doing literature reviews or, you know, something sort of like a broader lens, or maybe something sort of more like what Jessica was describing that she does. It's not like purely stats all the time. And then I think sometimes some of those older school people might view like an MS as like, you're a stats person, like you're focused on that. Maybe you had more theory and less of the more statistical theory and less of like the general public health. I don't know if that's true in your programs, it might not be, but I think if people who are like, you know, went to school 20 years before me or more, might, I think, probably perceive it like that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I must say, you know, now when we're interviewing, we really don't make a distinction. It's, you know, it's very much, you know, what the person's coursework was. You know, frankly, a lot of it is also, I hate to use this term, but soft skills. You know, they're just as important as what they've been trained in, you know, in terms of statistical theory or clinical trials. So.
Great. Thank you. Okay, what about the question of master's versus PhD? So you all have master's degrees, and how do you fit in at your setting? Do most people who do statistics or data analysis or data science, do most of them have PhDs, or is there really no difference in practice between the master's level and the doctoral level people? What's your take on that?
This is Martin. I work in the FDA. I have to say that I have the privilege of practicing statistics with a master's degree. Meanwhile, all of my colleagues are they are all PhDs. And I think it's just a matter of the starting point of the people's career. For people who are just fresh out of school, then I think having a PhD would definitely help them to get in the door in the clinical trial space, you know, for the government at least. But when I entered into the FDA, I was already had some about 10 years of, you know, doing clinical studies under my belt. So it in some way compensate. But I think in general, I have my general advice to anyone who are very devoted to statistics is, regardless, at the very beginning, you will feel a bit uncomfortable by surrounding by PhD, but don't forget why you are here is because you want to do statistics. The rest is not very important. You will learn, you will not only learning from them, they may also learn from you. I would say that statistics is actually a very dynamic and evolving discipline. As we all know, I still very vividly remember attending an ASA seminar offered by Dr. Botansky, and I think it was amazing. And then now, I mean, all of a sudden, time flies, and it becomes almost like a common knowledge. I think it is really evolving that way. And I saw a lot of people after that getting their PhDs, they thought that they claimed the field that they were writing a dissertation on for life. But I think it's almost like an illusion. Everyone needs to work hard. But most importantly, we are there for fun. Anything else is secondary.
Great. Any other comments on that?
I think it really depends on the industry and what types of positions you are pursuing. But in the end, if people pursue a PhD degree, they don't just want a job, right? They basically want an academic career. So that's why people pursue a PhD degree. If you just want that, but of course it's true that. If you want to go into to do clinical trial in big pharm, you need a PhD in biostatistics. That's many graduates of we know, yeah, like from NYU, they went to big pharms. Basically, they require a PhD degree.
Good, thank you. Anybody else have any questions, or any panelists want to add any words of wisdom?
Let me take the first step on that question.
Okay.
I interact with a lot of different scientists with different disciplines, and they more or less each scientific and engineering space have mature more or less in the sense of the application of statistics. So they are very well versed in terms of p-values, don't overfitting data, and all these, linear regression or regression modeling type of strategy. So I definitely would encourage everyone to learn a bit more about, the causal inference. I think that aspect is I see is a very highly impactful area, because this is where statistician can make a big difference. I remember I interviewed someone who used to work at Google, and I asked him about the big data questions and the machine learning. And he just basically told me that every day he has more than 25 million data points. And every day they just, come up with new problems, and then they just run their statistics models and then that's it. And then they throw it away and then start from scratch for another questions. But they never think much about the causal inference aspect of the problem. And I think in terms of, web page determining whether a button is red or right or white, then of course it wouldn't, cause that deep of thought. But for more deeper product development, such as developing a machine learning algorithm that can help detect a certain type of heart condition or vision problems, then I think causal inference in that space can make a very big difference. And this is where, from my perspective, the meal ticket of statistician for the future. Meanwhile, everybody is crazy about machine learning, but to me, it's just another tool. That can be suitable to be used. But philosophically, I think statistics will still be driving the steering wheel if we want to. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Well, I will jump in, and I can't resist after what Matt said, and maybe Ruth and maybe others said as well about the importance of asking questions as you're considering, as you're interviewing or considering jobs. It reminds me, many years ago, I was interviewing for a PhD program in statistics. I was at University of Chicago interviewing for their program. I met with Steven Stigler, who is a very famous statistician who has done a lot of work in the history of statistics. And it was the end of a really long day, and I talked to so many different faculty and students, and I was tired. And at the end of the day, I met with him, and he said, "Well, what are your questions?" And I said, "I've been here all day. I've asked all of my questions." And his response was, "Be a good statistician and ask them again."
Yes. I absolutely have had people say that if I'm the last in the roster. You should ask, because you should see if I give the same answer or not. Yes, absolutely.
That's right. Everything is an experiment, or could be. Although, the causal inference is important as well.
Yes.
Okay, so last chance for anybody to add anything, any participants?
I was looking at one of the answered questions and someone said, did you ever feel unprepared in the beginning of your career path? Yes, absolutely. I actually have to say, I felt for the first couple of years, there's, this imposter syndrome. I can't believe they're calling me a statistician. And I mean, those first few years working were actually pretty exciting because you're learning so much. But frankly, I will be honest with you, there was a lot of things I think I had a good foundation in school, but there's a lot of things you just got to pick up on the job. I mean, especially in clinical trials, there's all sorts of, regulations and it's an alphabet soup of acronyms. And I'm like, ugh. So I do have to say, the beginning couple of years, yeah, there was, a little extra time that I had to spend sort of just getting up to speed. But I look back on those years very fondly, because I feel like I never learned so much as I did in those first couple of years.
Yes, I would like to add on what Matt said. For me, I think that's the reasons why we can earn a living as a statistician, because of uncertainty. If everything is so certain, then who needs a statistician? So there's a reason why we call a statistical discipline as a learning discipline. So I think what is important is not knowing the answer, but having a well-considered game plan to move forward and go adaptive and driven by the empirical evidence that we gather along the way. So that is the statistical way, so.
Great. And in our last few minutes, a couple more questions popped up. So this is one that is sort of a general question and of course, very important to all of us. As statisticians, what does the work-life balance look like in your field? So I don't know if anyone wants to take that on.
One thing, so I would recommend people ask that of their as one of their questions, what do you do in terms of looking out for, do people ever work more than 40 hours a week? And if they say, actually, I'll be honest with you, in my field, if they say, oh, never, they're lying and you shouldn't work there. I mean, because when you're doing, a drug submission and, there are periods where you're going to be working a little bit extra. Hopefully that's offset by times where it's not quite so busy. So it's like on average, it's manageable. It is challenging. I think in, our particular field, there's actually more work than people. And that's a good thing to have in terms of job security. But it is actually, there can sometimes be more work than you can handle. And so I think it is important to ask that question and see what sort of response you get and how comfortable you are with that response.
I just want to add on to that. In general, I think it's depending on the organization that you're working for. But who would have thought, about the COVID pandemic? My center, basically running 24/7, no holidays, no Thanksgiving, run straight, and one person doing two person's job and trying to crush out all these, vaccines and all these, submissions. So it's really hard to tell, but I suspect that at that position, you would be, enjoying that kind of loss of balance for just a while because you are making a contribution. But otherwise, I think different organizations has different culture. So if someone wants to be, fully engaged for the career development, then I think there will be opportunities. But if not, there are other choices as well.
Anybody else?
When I worked at academic medical centers, I worked about probably like 40 hours a week. So I think that with that type of thing, it's a good, like, the pay is not as high as an industry, but you have good hours and good benefits, and it's relatively like, you know, when you can go home and that type of thing. And then, yeah, I mean, I talked to some of my former classmates who worked at like big, one who worked at like a big CRO when I was thinking about switching to industry. And like, I was a little bit intimidated by how much she works. Like, I mean, a lot of hours and, you know, travel, this is before the pandemic, you know, travel and sort of like things like that. But I don't know, with my new position, I think I've only been there about 4 months. It hasn't been such crazy hours. I think it might be partly because I'm sort of like in-house in this company. I don't have clients demanding things like at all hours. And also I sort of, before the pandemic, I had thought about these remote biostats jobs in industry and even interviewed for them a little bit, but I thought it sounded unhealthy to stay home in your apartment all day and like never go anywhere, not actually get up and go to work. But yeah. Then once I was, you know, doing that anyway, I thought, you know, it's an opportunity to try something that I had thought about. And I think also partly, mm-hmm. so now that I work in industry, I don't spend any time commuting. So I'm not as, you know, if there are times when the workload is busier, it might sort of balance out to, you know, at least when I work in the Bronx, I spend an hour commuting there and back. So every day. So it might shake out to be similar, although I'm sure in the long term, you know, I don't know if I'll stay remote forever, but you know, in the long term, I'm sure there are pros and cons of working from home, but I guess it's also something to think about. I suspect, because even there were, you know, biostats, data science type of jobs, even before the pandemic, they were fully remote. And I suspect that'll become, you know, more popular, that certain things will just stay remote, or like you go to the office a few times a year, you know, so it's something to think about.
Yes, I have some good news for Ruth. Wait for October. Starting from October, you will, things will pick up a little bit.
And that's coming straight from the FDA, no.
Yes. Yeah, just coming from someone who worked for sustainable devices, yeah. You know, for 10 years. Yep.
So let me, so we got a great last question. So what I'd like to do is sort of give everybody a chance to give a short answer to the question, what is your favorite part of being a statistician or biostatistician or however you consider, whatever title you give yourself. So what's your favorite part of that? Anybody, we don't have to go in any particular order.
I guess I can start. Like, there's always a new challenge to tackle, and I always like to learn new things. So I think that has been like great. So it's not like a repetitive job all the time.
Great.
I'll go next. I guess the thing that I kind of like is, you know, there's some jobs where you're like, you don't see a very immediate, you don't see an immediate effect of your work. And I sort of feel, well, it's not immediate, but I feel like, you know, our data monitoring activities that we're doing, it has a very real effect on looking out for the interests of patients. And you see the results of your work and the decisions that are made actually very quickly. And so that's gratifying. I'm not patient.
Yeah. I think it's just because statistics is very interesting. I think it's a very interesting field. I think it helps us to think more critically. And I recommend a book by Daniel Kahneman, you know, Think Fast and Slow. I think that's a very good book to read.
Uh-huh. Great.
Speaking of books, I have another recommendation. There's recently a new book out called Data Detective by Tim Horton. He basically is talking about a book trying to influence people, or at least the reader, the importance of statistics in the world of fake data and fake news. People are trying to throw doubt into people's mind about the existence of ever important or accurate data. And some of the people are, you know, from statisticians from Greece, from other places, as we can experience, the turmoil in the world, it becomes more and more important as a statistician's role to convey to a certain level of truth to the society that we are living in. I think is completely irreplaceable, and it also requires a certain type of courage for us to do good and be really respected of the role that is given to us. Thank
Great.
You.
Thank you. Anybody, any last words on what you like about being a statistician from anybody? And Ruth, I don't know if we heard from you. I don't know. You don't have to comment if you want to.
I would say it's nice. It's nice to sort of like be needed and play such an important part of, especially sometimes if you work with investigators who think statistics is just like you plug in some numbers into a computer and the result pops out and it doesn't involve any thinking. And then you work with them and they realize like how much intellectual engagement and how, it was required and back and forth between the statistician and the researcher. So I think sort of like being appreciated for the critical role that we play is kind of nice. And then also I think there's like some statistician who has a quote about like the best part is like getting to play in everyone's backyard. Like you can sort of switch from area to area or industry to industry, and you'll have some skills that are transferable to all different sorts of interesting things. So I think that's a nice thing also.
Great, wonderful. Well, this was fantastic. And I wanna thank our panelists for giving their time and joining us and teaching us about what you do and how you got there and what your views are. So this was incredibly valuable. I know it will be for our students, and I thank you very, very much. And thank you to all of our participants, and good night or good morning to everyone, mm-hmm. wherever you are. Okay, take care, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.